Hello viewers, many of you have requested me for Act 5, Scene 1 of Merchant of Venice, and it's a big scene. This is the last scene where it is as if a summing up of the drama. So since it's a big scene, I won't be able to do it in one video. I'll have to split it into two. So I will do it till I'll try to do it till where Antonio and the rest come, reach Belmont. So I will do till there. And before I start the video, as I always say, have you subscribed to my channel? If not, please do. And press the like button if you have liked it. And yes, you are watching your Ranjana ma'am's channel, or rather it's your channel. So without wasting any more time, it's quite late in the night, so without wasting any more time, I'll proceed. So Act 5, Scene 1, this is where we find Belmont, Portia's house, and Portia's house at this moment is devoid of her. Portia and Nerissa, they are absent, so is Bassanio and Gratiano. So this household has been left under the care of Lorenzo and Jessica. So enter Lorenzo and Jessica. The moon shines bright. In such a night as this, when the sweet wind did gently kiss the trees, and they did make no noise. In such a night, Troilus, methinks, mounted the Trojan walls, and sighed his soul towards the Grecian tents where Cressid lay that night. So Lorenzo is commenting on the bright moonlight, and he says the moonlight is so bright, and on such a night when the sweet wind was breathing so gently as if it was kissing the trees, and the trees made no sound. And that time what happened? Troilus, he climbed the walls of Troy, and looked in a loving manner where he sighed his soul as it out, as he looked towards the Grecian tents where his beloved Cressida was sleeping that night. So Troilus is the son of King Priam of Troy. He's the prince of Troy, and he was in love with a woman called Cressida. And Cressida that night lay in the Grecian camp. She had been taken there. Jessica, in such a night did Thisbe fearfully overtrip the dew, and saw the land shadow o'er himself, and ran dismayed away. So in a night like this, Thisbe walked fearfully, that means in a apprehensive or in a timid manner. She was walking on the dewy grass, and she saw the shadow of a lion before her. She had come to meet her lover Pyramus, but before she saw him, she saw a lion. So being frightened, she ran away. So the story goes that Pyramus and Thisbe, it's Pyramus or Pyramus, some people pronounce it. So it's a proper noun. You can pronounce it as you feel. So Thisbe and her lover Pyramus or Pyramus, they were not allowed to marry. Their parents were against their marriage. So they planned to meet in the forest. And what happened? Before Pyramus could reach, Thisbe came and she saw the lion and she ran away. And when she ran away, her cloak, she had left her cloak. By chance, the cloak fell to the ground or whatever it is. And she ran away, frightened. And Pyramus came and he found Thisbe's cloak there, and a lot of blood on the face of the lion. So he thought that the lion must have killed Thisbe. So what did he do? I don't remember what happened, but it was a sad end. So it happened when? In a night like this. So Jessica also has to say something, which Lorenzo has said about the night, so she also won't be left behind. She's quite witty. Lorenzo, in such a night, stood Dido with a willow in her hand upon the wild sea banks, and waft her love to come again to Carthage. Dido was the queen of Carthage, and when Troy was set to fire, Aeneas, one of the Trojan, famous Trojan heroes, he ran away with his father on his back. And Aeneas came to Carthage, and Dido had fallen in love, so they had quite some good time. But after that, Aeneas left Carthage and went away, so Dido was heartbroken. So she carried a branch of the willow tree in her hand. It was symbolic of broken love or jilted love. And then it was said that she committed suicide by drowning herself. So in such a night, what did Dido do? She stood with a willow in her hand on the wild seashore, and she as if made signs to her lover Aeneas to return to her. Jessica, again, in such a night, Medea gathered the enchanted herbs that did renew old Aeson. So on a night like this, what did Medea do? Medea gathered the magic herbs which brought back the youthful vigor of her father-in-law Aeson. Who was Aeson? Aeson was her father-in-law. You remember Jason in Act 1, Scene 1? The one who had acquired the golden fleece. He had done it with the help of Medea. And then Jason had brought Medea to his country and they got married. And with her knowledge of the magic herbs which she collected at moonlight, she renewed or brought back the youthful vigor and vitality of her old father-in-law, Aeson. Lorenzo, in such a night, did Jessica steal from the wealthy Jew and with an unthrift love did run from Venice as far as Belmont. So yeah, on such a night, Jessica ran away from the wealthy Jew, that means the rich Jew, her father, and eloped with her spendthrift lover from Venice to Belmont. So now this is coming in the personal level. Jessica, in such a night did young Lorenzo swear he loved her well, stealing her soul with many vows of faith and never a true one. So Jessica says, yes, yes, in this type of night, Lorenzo declared that he loved Jessica a lot. He stole her soul with many promises of faith, but none of them were true. So now they'll go on leg pulling each other. So Lorenzo says, in such a night did pretty Jessica, like little shrew, slander her love, and he forgave it her. So in such a night, pretty Jessica, like a shrew. Shrew is a bad-tempered woman. There is a drama written by Shakespeare, The Taming of the Shrew. So shrew is a bad-tempered woman. So he says, like a bad-tempered woman, she insulted her lover. But he forgave her or blamed her lover and he forgave her. So Jessica, I would outnight you did nobody come, but hark, I hear the footing of a man. So she says that I could carry on this competition of in such a night and outnight you if no one had come, but I hear the footsteps of someone. So who comes? Stephano, he's a messenger. Who comes so fast in the silence of the night? A friend. A friend? What friend? Your name, I pray you, friend. So what friend? Tell me your name. Stephano is my name, and I bring word my mistress will, before the break of day, be here at Belmont. She doth stray about by holy crosses, where she kneels and prays for happy wedlock hours. So my name is Stephano. And I bring the news that my lady will be back before morning. She will be back at Belmont. And she is now, at this moment, she is among holy crosses in the church where she is kneeling and praying for her happy married life. Who comes with her? None but a holy hermit and her maid. This holy hermit portion is also a lie, because Portia is coming only with Nerissa. I pray you, is my master yet returned? He is not, nor we have not heard from him. But go we in, I pray thee, Jessica, and ceremoniously let us prepare some welcome for the mistress of the house. So Lorenzo says, no, he has not come, neither have we heard from him. But Jessica, let us go inside and get ready to give a formal welcome to the lady of the house. Now Lancelot comes. His job is to create some humor. Lancelot, sola, sola, Ho, ha, ho, sola, sola. So he's calling out. Lorenzo, who calls? Sola, did you see Master Lorenzo? Master Lorenzo, sola, sola. So did you see Master Lorenzo? He knows this person is Master Lorenzo who is asking him the question. And yet to create humor, he's, since it is dark, so in order to create some humor, though he has identified the voice, and yet he's saying, Master Lorenzo, sola, sola. So leave holaing man here. So stop shouting man, I am here. Sola, where? Here. Tell him there is a post come from my master with his horn full of good news. My master will be here ere morning. So tell him means tell Lorenzo. So he's telling Lorenzo only that tell Lorenzo that a messenger has come with good news that my master will reach here before morning. And he leaves. Lorenzo, sweet soul, let's in and there expect their coming. So he tells Jessica, sweet soul, let's get in and expect their coming. Mani, let's get in and expect them to come there. They will be coming there, so let's wait for them there. Then suddenly second thoughts come to him. So he says, yet no matter, why should we go in? My friend Stefano, signify, I pray you, within the house your mistress is at hand. So my friend Stefano, so I am requesting you that go and announce inside the household that your mistress is about to come, is at hand, she's close by. And bring your music forth into the air. That means bring your musicians out in the open to play their music to give Portia a very ceremonious welcome. So exit Stefano. Stefano gets his orders and so he leaves. How sweet the moonlight sleeps upon this bank. Here the moonlight is being personified as a woman. Here will we sit and let the sounds of music creep into our ears. So we will sit here and allow music to enter our ears. Soft stillness and the night becomes the touches of sweet harmony. So silence and the quietness of the night, they are the exact things we need for sweet music. Mane, they are the best setting or appropriate setting to enjoy sweet music. Sit, Jessica. Look how the floor of heaven is thick inlaid with patterns of bright gold. There is not, so he is telling Jessica, that Jessica, just sit and see how the sky is as if like the floor of heaven, that means the sky is thick inlaid with patterns of bright gold. That means how it is decorated with bright gold, he refers to the stars. There is not the smallest orb which thou beholdest, but in his motion like an angel sings. So the smallest star that you also see, that also produces music like an angel's song. So you won't find even the smallest star in the sky also, which does not sing like an angel. That means all the stars which you see in the sky, even if it is the smallest star, it sings like an angel. Still choiring to the young eyed cherubims, such harmony is in immortal souls. So they are also as if singing. Still choiring to the young eyed cherubims, so they are as if singing to the bright eyed angels, such harmony is in immortal souls. So there exists such harmony in the soul, is in immortal souls. Souls are immortal. Even our human body, it is liable to be destroyed. But the soul within us, that is immortal, that doesn't die. So, but whilst this muddy vesture of decay, our body, doth grossly close us in, we cannot hear it. So we cannot hear this celestial or heavenly music. Why? Because our soul is enclosed in this muddy vesture of decay or in this gross body. Enter musicians. Come ho and wake Diana with a hymn. So he is telling the musicians to come and wake Diana with a hymn. Hymn means a prayer song. And who is Diana? Diana is the goddess of the moon. She is also the goddess of hunting. She is also the goddess of chastity or purity. So she holds quite a few portfolios. As you say, in the central government, we have another cabinet ministers. having more than one portfolio. So she also holds authority over the knight, over hunting, and over virginity. With sweetest touches, pierce your mistress's ear and draw her home with music. So let the sweet music reach your mistress's ears and welcome her home. Jessica, I'm never merry when I hear sweet music. So when I hear sweet music, I am never lively. The reason is your spirits are attentive. You are never lively because you are attentive. You listen to it. Actually, remember Jessica had said now that her house is hell. Her father wouldn't allow any music to enter her house. So as a result, what happened? Whenever Jessica hears music, she is so attentive to the music that she cannot react in a lively manner because she's engrossed in listening to the music. This is Lorenzo's explanation. For do but note a wild and wanton herd or race of youthful and unhandled colts, fetching mad bounds, billowing and neighing loud, which is the hot condition of their blood. If they but hear perchance a trumpet sound or any air of music touch their ears, you shall perceive them make a mutual stand, their savage eyes turn to a modest gaze by the sweet power of music. So he brings in the reference of the colts. Colts are untrained horses, young horses, before they are trained. So they keep on jumping and prancing and all that. But as they, if any strains of music enter their ears, then there is a radical transformation in them. Their savage looks, they disappear and they become very attentive to the sounds of music. So, you shall perceive them make a mutual stand, their savage eyes turn to a modest gaze by the sweet power of music. So, this is what happens to them when they hear some music. Therefore, the poet did feign that Orpheus drew trees, stones and floods, since not so stockish, hard and full of rage, but music for the time thus changed this nature. So, he says, poet here refers to Ovid. Ovid had created the character of Orpheus, who could play wonderfully on a musical instrument called the lyre, L-Y-R-A. It was a stringed instrument, and Orpheus played the lyre so wonderfully that it had effect. It had its effect not only on human beings, but on animals and also on trees, plants, water, everything. Stones, they also as it became animate. So, Orpheus drew trees, stones and flood here refers to river. Since not so stockish, hard and full of rage, but music for the time doth change this nature. So, whatever, even whatever, there is no, whichever material, well, there, nothing can escape the influence of music. So, for at least some time, it will change its nature. The man that hath no music himself, nor is not moved with concord of sweet sounds, is fit for treason, stratagems and spoils. That means the man who does not love music or who is not influenced by sweet melody, this person is capable of doing all the vicious acts. He can betray people, he can plan conspiracies, he can do dishonest acts. He is fit for all these. The motions of his spirit are dull as night and his affections dark as Erebus. Let no such man be trusted. Mark the music. So the soul of this man who has no place for music in his heart, this man's soul is as black as the night and his wishes are as dark as hell. Erebus. Erebus means hell. So this man should never be trusted. And now Portia and Nerissa enter. Portia, that light we see is burning in my hall. How far that little candle throws his beams, so shines a good deed in a naughty world. So they have not yet entered. They are at a distance, and from there they can see the candle that is burning in the hall. So she is telling that the candle which I see is burning in my hall. So this is a small candle, and just see yet how it lightens up the atmosphere. So in the same way, when everyone is vicious, one good act also stands apart from the rest. It shines among the others. Narissa, when the moon shone, we did not see the candle. Yeah, but moon, which is a greater source of light than the candle. So in the presence of the moon, the candle was not visible. Mane, we did not see the candle. So doth the greater glory dim the less. A substitute shines brightly as a king until a king be by. And then his state empties itself as doth an inland brook into the main waters. Music, hark. So she says, greater glory always overshadows the lesser one. So the substitute, money, a person who acts in the place of the king when the king is not there. So he shines in his own glory. But the moment the king returns, how? He becomes as if like an inland brook which empties itself into the river. So when the brook empties itself into the river, it loses its own identity. Why? Because the greater water body, it's what, mane, it makes it lose its identity. Suppose in load shedding, when there is load shedding and you light a candle, so that candle will be seen from quite a distance. But the moment the light comes back, then the candle becomes useless. Because the greater glory, the tube light, it swallows the lesser glory, overshadows the lesser glory, that is the candle. So then she hears music. It is your music, madam of the house. So Narissa reminds her that this music which you are hearing, it is your musicians who are playing. Narissa, nothing is good, I see, Portia, nothing is good, I see, without respect. Methinks it sounds much sweeter than by day. So Portia now realizes a very vital truth, that nothing is good unless it is in certain conditions. So she had been accustomed to hear this music during daytime. And today when she hears it at night, it sounds sweeter to her. Why? Because this time it is silent. Silence makes you enjoy music much better. So Narissa speaks that. Silence bestows that virtue on it, madam. Yeah, so silence makes this music sound so sweet. Portia, the crow doth sing as sweetly as the lark when neither is attended. And I think the nightingale, if she should sing by day, when every goose is cackling, would be thought no better a musician than the wren. How many things by season seasoned are to their right praise and true perfection. Peace, hope. The moon sleeps with Endymion and would not be awake. So Portia says that the crow can sing in a same sweet manner as the lark when none of them are accompanied by other sounds. That means when there is no other sound, then the crow's song also. That is rubbish. I don't agree. The crow's sound is so harsh. Anyway, Portia let her have her opinion. So, and she says that nightingale is noted for its sweet music. And it sings at night. So according to Portia, if nightingale were to sing during daytime, when every bird is cackling or making noise, then her song would be rated as no better than the song of a wren. I don't know how a wren sings. W-R-E-N. Wren and Martin's wren. Just joking. Acha. And then, many things become improved when they are performed at the right time. And so they get praise for their perfection. So the time is a vital factor. And then she says, peace, the moon sleeps with Endymion. So moon is being personified here. So she is telling her musicians to stop because the moon is sleeping by her lover Endymion and does not wish to be roused. So the music stops. Lorenzo, that is the voice, or I am much deceived, of Portia. So Lorenzo says that is the voice, it seems to be, of Portia. If I am not deceived, that is the voice of Portia which I hear. Portia, he knows me as the blind man knows the cuckoo by the bad voice. So blind man cannot see the cuckoo, but he hears the sweet song and he says, oh, it's the cuckoo singing. So Portia says, Lorenzo also knows me by my voice, but it's not a sweet voice, it's the bad voice. My voice is not as sweet as the cuckoo, she says. Some people say it cuckoo. No, not cuckoo, it's cuckoo. Lorenzo, dear lady, welcome home. Portia, we have been praying for our husband's health. With speed, we hope, the better for our words. Are they return? So we have, just see what a lie she's telling. This is very ironical. She's telling that we have been praying for the good health of our husbands. With speed, we hope the better for our words. And I hope that they are all better because of our prayers. Have they returned? Because she knows that they haven't returned. Madam, they are not yet, but there is come a messenger before to signify their coming. No, madam, they haven't come. They haven't returned as yet, but a messenger has come and informed that they are on the way and soon would be reaching. Portia, go in Nerissa, give order to my servant that they take no note at all of our being absent hence. Nor you, Lorenzo, Jessica, nor you. So Portia tells Nerissa, Nerissa, go inside and tell the servants that they should not, they must not show that we had been absent. We had been not in our palace. We had been away from the palace. They should not mention or talk about it. And Jessica and Lorenzo, nor you should mention about our absence. And then they hear the sound of a trumpet. Your husband is at hand. I hear his trumpet. So Lorenzo tells Portia that my lady, your husband has come because I hear his trumpet. And then we are no telltales, madam, fear you not. So madam, we are not telltales. We just don't go on telling about one person to the other. So like in Hindi, there is a word na chugalkhor. Chugli karna, chugalkhor. So we are not telltales. Madam, don't be afraid. This night, methinks, is but the daylight sick. It looks little paler. It is a day, such as the day is when the sun is hit. Actually, it's not yet morning. That is why the light is very faint. It's, we can call it dawn, or rather before dawn. Mane, night has not yet completely ended. So a little bit of the darkness and a little bit of light, it's that juncture. So she says that the night is gone, but this is a very weak type of daylight. It looks very pale, as on a day when the sun is hidden or by the clouds, or it's an overcast sky. Enter Bassanio, Antonio, and Graciano and their followers. So I told you that I will do it in this two parts. So for the time being, I'll end my video here. And the remaining part, I will do it in my second video. So wait and watch for it. And for the time being, let me bid you goodbye. Have a happy time.